It's almost unreal that so much of what we call modern physics has happened on this campus in these walls. We're really moving from science fiction to science facts.
Columbia has a really rich history in quantum. It really all started with I.I. Rabi, who truly brought quantum mechanics over to the US from Germany when he studied. He was among the first to actually be exposed to the new ideas. On the scientific side, he actually did something quite amazing early on. He really was the pioneer of turning around the idea from we only observe quantum systems to we want to control quantum systems.
Columbia's legacy starts with a lot of the pioneering works that have been done over the past 100 years, including Rabi's work on magnetic resonance that forms the foundation of MRIs, Town's predecessor of the laser, he invented the maser here. But more recently, I would say there's been a huge push towards nanomaterials and quantum materials.
Columbia has a very strong history in optical quantum materials. The Nobel Prize winner of the quantum dot is a Columbia professor, Lou Bruce. The current strength is the research in what we call quantum materials, materials that derive their properties from quantum interactions.
There's many world-leading experts at Columbia working on nanomaterials, both people who make the materials, people who characterize the materials, and people who calculate their properties. And I think this will be an enormous legacy in quantum research going forwards.
Just very recently, we showed with colleagues in photonics here at Columbia a new method to actually make arrays where you can have the hope to trap 100,000, maybe even a million atoms, single atoms. And that will be an amazing quantum resource. Going forward, I think what we'll see is controlling complex quantum systems, building quantum systems from the bottom up with many particles connected and entangled. And we'll probably see amazing scientific results from that, but also new types of technology that come from this enhanced control over quantum systems.
We manipulate light on a chip, and these circuits of light, they are opening the door for new applications in quantum. So for applications where communication is important, light is the way to go.
So the cross-section of this is less than a micron squared. And so the idea is if you wanted to make atomic clocks that were portable, that could, let's say, be shot out into satellites, into space, this was the type of technology that you'd want to implement.
By making these things more compact, you can have more of them on a single chip. They also could become more power efficient. There's lots of advantages to getting small. It also enables you to think about applications that you couldn't before, like handheld quantum computers.
We're getting to the stage where we can build material function electron by electron. So we can design materials that can do whatever we need them to do or whatever we want them to do. This has a huge impact on the ability to build quantum hardware, quantum computers, quantum sensors, and new types of microscopes that really leverage the quantum properties like entanglement to realize function that we simply cannot achieve now.
This new century, we start to utilize what we have discovered in the past century and try to make it into devices that could achieve functionalities otherwise impossible for classical devices.
All our current technology, information and sensing and internet and communications ultimately run on quantum physics and on materials changing their properties. So finding new ways of doing this is a very important endeavor and rewarding too.